So Michael was our joy, and he came so beautiful, but he was, he was a low birth weight baby. He suffered complications during delivery, and then the doctor's reports confirmed it. And the doctors were saying, yeah, this is going to just get worse. And, from the age of two, things would get even worse. And he'll probably, die in his early 20s. No, something is wrong here. Because I know that Jesus is someone who took all the sickness of everyone. And there was not a single sick person who came to him who went away sick. That healing that Jesus paid the price for somehow is not manifesting in my child. And there is nobody who has hope for it. And I knew that Michael is one day going to be perfectly healed and completely restored. And I began to stand for it. I began to fight for it. And I keep on seeking the Holy Spirit's help on how, Lord, how should I pray now? And this has been so amazingly liberating. It's everything I wanted. It's everything I want the Holy Spirit to do in me and through me. And I'm seeing it come to pass. He's going to bring it to completion. He is going to complete the good work he's begun, and he who has called us is faithful. He will do it. So, praise God. Praise God. My name is Priya Calmiano. I'm from Bangalore, India. I'm married to Colin Calmiano, who's a full-time missionary for the past more than 30 years. I'm in the full-time mission too, from 1994. From a very early childhood, I remember loving the Lord in my own little ways. I used to love to sing, so you would probably, even as a child, I would sing the loudest in church, and I loved praising God. I had a beautiful and a simple, very childlike relationship with the Lord. And yes, as a family, we're good Catholics. We grew up, going for Sunday Mass, and the rosary was a daily, time of family gathering for prayer together. But as I grew up, I think it's just the mercy of the Lord, He touched me at a very early age. When I was just about 16 years old, I attended my first charismatic retreat, and my life with the Lord really became so much deeper, so much stronger, because God became so real to me. The spiritual director of Bangalore at that time, the Charismatic Renewal, he asked me if I would be willing to assist a person in Kerala who was doing children's retreats. And she was looking for help with Christine retreats. And I grew, I really, really grew in that time. I spent almost 3.5 years working with them. And it was during this time, I sensed a deep desire to do something similar in Bangalore, to start a children's ministry, to reach out to children in schools in Bangalore, because I knew a lot of college retreats were happening, but not much was being done for children in the school level. I began a ministry here in Bangalore under the guidance of the Charismatic Renewal at that time. And it just so happened that Colin actually was the chairman of the renewal. And he was very supportive, and he was a wonderful, I think many people who know him as a very, realistic and a solid person who's really, really solid in the Lord. And so my association with Colin was very, very, in this kind of totally informal kind of a relationship. He would guide me, and he was that, preacher. He was the chairman of the renewal. And, so it was not like I had any special feelings for Colin or anything like that. But there was a time when, we did almost for one whole year, we did a lot of retreats for teachers. There was an amazing opening that we got. And since I was free at that time, I would go to assist with worship and with teachings. And there was another team. There was a small team that led by Colin. So during this time, we got to know each other really well. And things, just fell into place for us. It was so beautiful how the Lord led us, and you know, one thing led to another, and we fell in love. And you know, within we got married in 1999, and it's 22 blessed and truly, truly amazing years as husband and wife, and as parents to our two beautiful children.
I'm so blessed because Priya is a woman after God's own heart, you know, and God has blessed her with a tremendous commitment, dedication. She loves the Lord, you know, she really loves the Lord. You can see it in her life, you know, you can see it in her cheerfulness, her smile, never a dull moment, never a sad moment. I've never seen, I think, Priya sad, you know, because she's got that exterior smile, that cheerfulness, you know, and cheerfulness also is an indication of your heart, right? It's an indication of the disposition of your heart. So what is within comes out. As long as we put the kingdom of God first in our lives, seek Him first, then the Holy Spirit takes control. Every step that you take is always the right step, you know, and it's always advancing you into the kingdom of God. It is advancing you into the plan of God, the will of God. And I've seen that amazing line, you know, it's a beautiful line that you go through, you know.
After we got married, our one desire was that we would serve the Lord together. And, you know, the words of Joshua were really our words. You know, as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. So our only desire was, you know, that our children also join us in ministry. And as a family, we will serve God in full-time mission. And we were blessed with a beautiful child, Michael, in the year 2001, in the month of June. He suffered complications during delivery. And what happened was he was in distress and he was almost dying. But unfortunately, his fetal heart rate was not being monitored. And so he was actually delivered out of an emergency C-section. And we just barely got him alive at that time. And he went through major complications during that time because as a low birth weight baby, he also suffered pulmonary hemorrhage. So because of which his lungs were very, very badly affected. And because of his weight, you know, it became all the more challenging for him. His very survival became a big question mark. But the Lord brought him through all this. Through all this, he, you know, the mercy of the Lord just rescued him. And he seemed to be, you know, looking and absolutely like a normal child. But we noticed that even as he was growing and developing, he used to cry a lot. He used to really, really scream and cry a lot. And we discovered much later, you know, that he was having seizures. So, because he suffered brain damage during that time, either probably in the womb itself or even when he was ventilated soon after birth. So, during that time, you know, he suffered brain damage because of which he was having seizures almost continuously. And they were a very different kind of seizures. It was not like the normal fits where the whole body would shake. So it was like, you know, jerky kind of movements, but it would disturb him a lot. He would cry and cry before the release would come in the form of a seizure. So during that time, we also happened to go to Malta, you know, because we were working with a mission organization and they posted us in Malta for a formation course. So we took Michael at the age of about 10 months. You know, it became quite obvious that Michael's milestones were all delayed. Someone suggested, you know, somebody from the ministry, they suggested, you know, why don't you go, you know, there are good hospitals here in Germany. Why don't you go and get Michael checked up? So we actually admitted him in hospital there for 3 days. And that was when, you know, the MRI, the CT scans and the EEGs, everything beyond doubt, it showed us that Michael had suffered severe right hemisphere brain damage, because of which all his milestones were delayed. His brain activity was like totally abnormal, because of which he was having seizures. And since the delays in milestones, he needed therapy of every kind. So when we came back to India, it was unimaginable. And because we were just running from doctor to doctor, from this specialist to that specialist, neurologists and physiotherapists and occupational therapists, speech therapists, you name it, you know, every kind of, specialist, we ended up having to see them. And he also had a very severe reflux issue. So, because of which he would vomit a lot and he would hardly be able to digest his food. And it was agony. You know, I can't even begin to tell you how much of misery it was, you know, to see him suffer, to see him struggle like this. Morning, noon and night, I was just taking care of him. He was on loads and loads of anti-epileptic drugs, because of which he was, so sleepy most of the time, just like a zombie. And yet, you know, those drugs did nothing to control the seizures. In fact, the type of seizures just kept changing. It was a condition called West syndrome, apparently a very difficult condition to treat because the type of seizures keeps changing in that particular condition. And that was what Michael had. And I remember when we were in Germany and we got all the reports, you know, and there they're very honest. You know, they say, yeah, this is the situation. Your child will not live very long. And I just don't know, something just broke within me. I just, all my faith, all the, you know, hope that I had, the trust in God, everything came crumbling and it just shattered me. You know, and as a mother, I was like totally, totally broken. I said, what is this? What's happened to our child? We wanted to serve God, you know, as a family. And here we have a child with such a severe, with so many problems. It's not like one or two, there were so many problems. It seemed like everything was an issue with Michael. And what made it so bad was, you know, because I just didn't know where God was in all this. I knew God is in control and He's there with us. But my only question was, Lord, where are you? Where are you? Where are you in this? And I would keep hearing His voice assuring me, saying, I'm with you. I am with you. But then the next question was, Lord, if you're with me, why aren't you doing something? You know, why aren't you healing my child? And so then that's all I used to pray for. I say, Lord, heal Michael. Lord, heal Michael. Lord, heal Michael. And somehow, you know, years and years went like this. We had actually, because the seizures were just getting worse, and you know, the neurologist, he was an epileptologist at that time, he suggested a brain surgery for Michael, you know, where we could, they said they will do a hemispherectomy, where they would disconnect the portion of the brain which was damaged and, you know, try and let Michael function with a healthy portion of his brain, because this portion which was damaged was causing all the seizures. So it was a very, very major surgery, and plus he would completely lose function of his left side. But we were willing to take a chance because the seizures were so horrible that, we were like, you know, caught between the devil and the deep sea, and we chose to go for the surgery. But one day before the surgery, an amazing miracle actually happened. The doctors took him off many of the medications that he was on. During that time, they said, okay, yes, we are taking him off many of his medications, but in case there's any emergency, we can always rush him to the hospital, to the ICU, because we had already been admitted for the surgery. And during that time, amazingly, the seizures just stopped. It stopped so dramatically that the next day was the surgery, and this guy was like totally seizure free. And I know thousands were praying for Michael across the world, because we had, you know, sent prayer requests saying that he's going to go through this major surgery and everything. And this is what happened. And the doctors were the most surprised. They said, we've never seen anything like this. You know, when we take the patient off medication, they usually have very bad seizures and, you know, it becomes almost like an emergency. But just the opposite happened. He was totally seizure free, and he has been. From that time, from the age of 5 and a half until now, Michael is 20 years old. We stopped all medication and he's continued to be perfect. And this is an amazing and beautiful thing that the Lord did for us. But my condition, you know, what was going on inside of me, that I was not, although I was so grateful to the Lord that Michael was healed of his seizures and, you know, walking, there was this continued desire to see him perfectly restored. Perfectly restored. That's what I wanted for my son. I was always asking questions like, why? Why is this happening to our child? Why did it happen in the first place? Who did it to my child? And I was hearing all kinds of answers. It was like, oh, this is God's will for him, and you must just embrace it. I know when he gets to heaven, Michael will get the bigger crown. And I was like, no, something is wrong here. And it was horrible. It was really, really horrible, because this is the kind of, you know, answers we would get from people. They would blame it on ancestral curses and generational sins, family tree. So we were offering masses and novenas and whatever. And I do hope, you know, all our ancestors are resting in peace. But it didn't make any difference to our child. You know, so somewhere something was seriously missing. And we could not see how that, you know, that healing that Jesus purchased for our child, you know, was just somehow not manifesting in his life. At this time, by the mercy of God, I read a book which my sister got me. Okay, this book, it really, really came as, you know, the grace of God, which touched my life when I was at my lowest moment. And I just want to thank God, because he never lets go. He never, ever lets go. And I read this book. This book is called God Heals Birth Defects. Okay? And it addresses those very issues that I was, you know, continually baffled by. Those questions that I was asking, you know, saying, why birth defects? Who did it? Why are children born like this? Why, you know, are there birth defects too? And every question that I have asked during those, you know, 12, 13 years when Michael was battling all these things, every one of them perfectly answered from the scriptures and very, very clearly, beyond a doubt. That book says, no sickness is the will of God. Jesus proved it by healing every sickness. If it was God's will, then he wouldn't have healed. Or he would have said, you know, come later, this is not your time. And, you know, none of those excuses that we probably, you know, give to those who need healing, or, you know, probably because we don't have the right answers. You know, we give excuses, give all kinds of wrong teachings. And because of this, you know, from being in a state of absolute despair and hopelessness, only the Lord and I know what I was like on the inside. God did not intend death. God never created sickness. It all came because of the envy of the devil. And that is the reason I really believe, you know, ultimately, I'm not too sure where there was an open door in our life through which the enemy found a place where he could attack our child. But this is, and we very clearly recognized it as the work of the enemy, and we began to fight it. And I realized that something was happening within me. I began to hear the Holy Spirit speak to me. The first thing the Holy Spirit led me to do was repent, because I was holding God ultimately responsible for Michael's condition.
We bring peace and hope, Lord, dispelling all kinds of
doubt. I got into a deep and intimate relationship with the Holy Spirit. As I was reading and praying in tongues, I found myself praying for hours in tongues. And the amazing thing was, you know, the Holy Spirit just restored faith to me. As I began to pray like this, we began to see results. He used to calm down. He used to get much more peaceful. And it was amazing how step by step, the Holy Spirit began to, you know, teach me the importance of praying for Michael. And I just prayed and prayed and prayed. And as I was praying, there was, you know, those rivers of living waters began to really flow out of my heart. And I have never been the same after that. I'm back in full-time ministry. I'm so much more focused on the Lord, on His kingdom. And the supernatural strength of the Holy Spirit continually enables me. I don't find myself falling sick, or even if there's any sickness, I just cast it out in Jesus' name. It's gone. And I really am amazed at what the Holy Spirit has done. And I'm excited. You know, I'm really, really excited. And I'm looking forward, looking to the future with such great hope.
So this has been our wonderful journey of triumph, a journey of victory. We are so joyful and we are so grateful to the Lord and to the Holy Spirit that this truth was revealed to us. Because I really believe that the Christian life is a life of triumph and not defeat. You know, Jesus came that we may overcomers, we may walk in victory, we may triumph in our life. Jesus Himself triumphed over everything. So that is the key to the Christian life, you know, not defeat, disappointment, or suffering, sickness. I don't think that is what the Christian life is all about. The Christian life is a journey of triumph. And we are blessed, Priya and myself are really blessed, you know, that many years back this truth came to us, and we realigned, you know, some things to this truth, and God has blessed it. It's so important, right, to when the truth comes to you, that you capture it, catch it, hold it, and run with it. You'll see results. And this is our journey. We are so blessed to be on this journey of triumph, and I'm sure it's going to continue, and it's going to continue for a long, long time. Praise God.
Searching for answers? Discover your true identity. Stay tuned to Shalom World.